would turn with me to Psalm 33 and read verses 8 and 22. Today we're in the sixth week of our study, What in the World's Going On, and I pray that if you've been here on Sunday mornings, that you have been in small groups in Sunday school, that the Lord has touched your heart. Perhaps He has made you shudder a time or two, made you feel a bit uncomfortable. Pray, Lord, know that above everything, that He has helped you to feel comfortable in Him, but also to feel thankful that He has brought you to a place of salvation. Because when the end times happen, it can be ugly for those who do not believe. So, as we've studied this, I pray that you've a refreshed, perhaps even a newfound, joy and appreciation for His gift of salvation in your life. Psalm 33, verses 8-22. Let all the earth fear the Lord, let all the people of the world revere Him. For He spoke and it came to be, He commanded and it stood firm. The Lord foils the plans of the nations, He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But the plans of the Lord stand firm forever, the purposes of His heart through all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people He chose for His inheritance. From heaven, the Lord looks down and sees all humankind. From His dwelling place, He watches all who live on earth. He who forms the hearts of all, who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army, no warrior escapes by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all its great strength, it cannot save. For the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear Him, on those whose hope is in His unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait and hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In Him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in His holy name. May Your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in You. I think we all would agree, or all would say yes to this, that we love our country, right?
Yes.
We love America, we love living here, being born here, being citizens of this country. And we want it to be prosperous, we want it to be successful. I would think that even we take great pride in being known as the most powerful country on the face of the earth, right? Nobody likes to be a wimp, right? We want to be the strong, the powerful, have the greatest military. When we appreciate and we honor those servicemen and women who have sacrificed much in order to help us become that powerful country, right? Those who are serving all around the world. And we hold dear the freedoms and the rights that we enjoy. Right? Right? We take those, we hold them close to our hearts. And it's because we love our country, it's because we enjoy all of those things, that we are concerned about our country's future. We love it so much that it becomes a major concern for us. What happens to America in the future? What will happen to the United States in the years to come? For hundreds of years, authors and scholars have speculated as to the fate of America. Much has been written about America's future in general, but also about what role it plays in the end times, and even if it is mentioned at all in the Bible. As far back as 1888, a woman named Ellen White, who eventually became part founder of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, wrote that America was indeed mentioned in Scripture and in the last days. Herbert Armstrong came along several years later. He was founder of the cult known as the Worldwide Church of God, and he believed that not only America was in the Bible, but that also Great Britain was present there as well. On the other side of things, in 1998, a work produced by Thomas Ice and Timothy Demme refuted those findings. They denied the presence of America in the Bible, in prophecy. They even went so far as to say, no country in the Western Hemisphere is listed in Scripture. Others have said that America is not identified specifically, but that it's mentioned in general when prophecy lists all the nations of the world, for example. Well, of course we fall under that. Yay, right? Many others could be mentioned, but the point is that there has been and will be, and is today, much discussion about America's future. Much discussion about America's place in prophecy. Much discussion about the end times and where is the United States. We ask, why doesn't our country get its act together and change its ways? We wonder, if we are the most powerful, the wealthiest country in the world, why can't we get things straightened out? And if we do get things fixed or straightened out, what does that then say about our future? Does that impact our future at all? Now, since we've been studying this, the end times and prophecy, some of you have asked me, what about America in the end times? And I'm sure as you've met in Sunday school or small groups, or just as you've interacted with each other throughout the weeks, you've perhaps asked that question yourself. What happens to America? Where is America in the end times? Does the Bible speak of the United States at all? Do we play any part, any role in the end times? When we consider how our country began, it is quite sad that we even have to ask that question. While there is debate as to whether or not our founding fathers were true Christians or were just Christian in name only or were simply deists, the truth is that when you look at what many of our founding fathers said or wrote or believed, God, Christ, and the Bible were terribly influential to them personally and to the creation of our country. Beginning with the Puritans and the Pilgrims who endured grueling travel across the Atlantic, they came to this country for religious freedoms and liberties. John Adams and John Hancock were quoted as saying, "We recognize no sovereign but God and no king but Jesus." James Madison said, "A watchful eye must be kept on ourselves, lest while we are building ideal monuments of renown and bliss here, we neglect to have our names enrolled in the annals of heaven." And would we today hear a Chief Justice say something like John Jay, our first Chief Justice, said, "Condescend, merciful Father, to grant as far as proper these imperfect petitions, to accept these inadequate thanksgivings, and to pardon whatever sin hath mingled in them for the sake of Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord and Savior, unto whom with thee and the blessed Spirit, ever one God, be rendered all honor and glory, now and forever." Would we hear a Supreme Court justice say anything remotely like that today? After his duel with Aaron Burr, a story is told of Alexander Hamilton as he lay on his deathbed. The Reverend Mason came to speak with him. And the Reverend Mason recounts this story. General Hamilton is speaking and he says, "I went to the field determined not to take his life." Reverend Mason says, he repeated this disavowal of all intention to hurt Mr. Burr. The anguish of his mind in recollecting what had passed and his humble hope of forgiveness from his God. I recurred to the topic of the divine compassion, the freedom of pardon in the Redeemer Jesus to perishing sinners. That grace, my dear general, which brings salvation is rich, rich. Yes, he interrupted, it is rich grace. And on that grace, continued I, a sinner has the highest encouragement to repose his confidence, because it is tendered to him upon the surest foundation. The Scripture testifying that we have redemption through the blood of Jesus, the forgiveness of sins according to the richness of his grace. Here, the general, letting go of my hand, which he had held from the moment I sat down at his bedside, clasped his hands together and looking upwards, up towards heaven, said with emphasis, "I have a tender reliance on the mercy of the Almighty through the merits of the Lord Jesus Christ." And would we hear from Congress what they stated in 1854? The great, vital, and conservative element in our system is the belief of our people in the pure doctrines and the divine truths of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And John Adams, once again, the general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. I will avow that I then believed and now believe that those general principles of Christianity are as eternal and immutable as the existence and attributes of God. When we hear those things, when we think about how our country was founded, when we understand the blessing that our country has been to Israel, we have to then stop and think, the Lord has indeed blessed us as a country. We saw this a few weeks ago when we examined that relationship between the U.S. and Israel. However, we have perhaps begun to see a lessening of that blessing because of our actions, because of our words, because of our deeds. It could be stated that America is experiencing a slow fade in three areas: morally, economically, and spiritually. When it comes to morals, our moral decline can be seen in at least two ways. There are others, I understand, but at least two ways, and that is in abortion and homosexuality. To us, these issues are more than just morals. Right? They are biblical issues. They are issues about what is right and what is wrong. But to others, in fact, to probably a majority, they are simply matters of rights and freedoms. And that plays into them being part of our downfall. Because they're acceptable, because they are what makes a person happy. So go ahead and do what makes you happy. There is no right and there is no wrong. Just do it. Since 1973, more than 53 million children have been aborted in our country. Presently, there are 13 states that have legalized same-sex marriage, with 9 or 10 more having done so by the end of 2014. Support for same-sex marriage has risen from 12% in 1988 to 53% in 2012. Our country is in a moral decline. Economically, there can be no question that our economy is struggling. Since 2008, millions of people have lost jobs. The unemployment rate has been close to all-time highs. Job creation has been slow at best. Millions have lost homes to foreclosures. And our country in the near future is facing unfunded liabilities that it does not have the money to meet. This includes things like Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Our debt is trillions and trillions of dollars, with very few, if any, ways of getting out. And spiritually, while America was founded on freedom of religion, that freedom has been stretched and distorted to the point where any God goes and any God is protected and any faith tolerated except the faith in the one true God. Any reference to the Ten Commandments is taken off walls and ushered out of buildings. People can pray to any God but Jesus. How can it be that the God who was worshipped by those who founded this country be pushed to the side? How can the God who blessed this country, putting it in the position to be a superpower, be marginalized and forgotten? We are in a spiritual slow fade. Then in light of this, the question still is there: what does the future hold for America? More specifically then, in light of what's going on, what does the Bible say about America? Is America mentioned? Are we in the end times? Are we in prophecy at all? We ask these questions, and we do so for many reasons. Two, I'd like to point out. One reason we ask them is because there are so many other countries that are mentioned. If you were to look at biblical prophecy and you had a commentary or a book to help you understand it, you would find that many of those countries mentioned there represent present-day countries. Obviously Israel, but there are many others. Egypt, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Iraq, Greece, Russia, Iran, Turkey, Sudan and Ethiopia, Libya, Algeria, and Saudi Arabia. And because all these countries are mentioned or play a role in prophecy, we ask ourselves, well, why not America? Why not the U.S.? It's not inconceivable. The second reason, then, that we ask that question is that it would seem to make sense that the world's remaining superpower would play a role in the end, right? If we consider that we are in the season of the end, doesn't it make sense that the strongest country, at least at one point the wealthiest, that could be debated today, I'm sure, would not have some sort of role in the end times? That it wouldn't play a part. But we've also all seen those movies or those TV shows or read those books where the hero isn't the strongest, the most popular, the most athletic person, but ends up being the weakling, the one who's picked on, the one who is outcast. Because of that, most scholars believe that that's what happens to the U.S. The U.S. is not there at the end. But the Bible does not mention America in prophecy. And if that is the case, why is that? I mean, what happens to us that we aren't there? That when God inspired the writers thousands of years ago, he knew something was going to happen to this great country, and he said, don't even mention them. Because they're not around, or they're not what they once were, or they won't factor in. There's an author, and he's a Jewish Christian named Joel Rosenberg. He actually worked for Israel and the prime minister at one point. He has offered four thoughts on what happens to America for her not to be around at the end. And the first is that there is an economic implosion. He believes that America could suffer a financial crisis so devastating that it prevents us from maintaining our superpower status. And the numbers from the last several years do nothing to dissuade us that that might not be a real possibility. In 2011, 14 million were unemployed, with another 8.5 million underemployed. Since 2006, more than 3 million foreclosures have taken place. Between the years 2007 and 2009, household wealth, right, our net average household wealth, dropped 23%. Since 2001, 42,400 American factories have closed. 45.8 million Americans were on food stamps in 2011. Not only are those figures staggering, but that doesn't even take into account the fact that our national debt is out of hand. I think the last time I saw it, it was approaching 17 million. And, or trillion, yeah, sorry, 17 trillion. Sorry, my mind brain is losing out of my ears saying the word trillion so many times. Yeah, 17 trillion. And there's, what, debates going on about raising that debt limit, right? That debt ceiling. So that it will go up before it comes down. Our debt to gross domestic product ratio was 100% in 2011. Meaning the amount we brought in was the same as the amount that we had to pay out. And that ratio is only going to get worse, meaning it's going to go from 100 to, experts think in a few years it'll be up to 130 to 140%. Meaning we're 30 to 40% behind every year. Here is a staggering illustration. If we were to pay $1 every second of every hour of every day of every month, it would take 32,000 years to pay off $1 trillion. Our debt is $17 trillion. I'll let you do the math as to how many years that might take. Please come, Lord Jesus, right? And those numbers don't include our obligations to fund things like Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, which will total about $57 trillion. Our economy is in a mess. And without difficult and different decisions, the U.S. could well face a financial collapse. A second reason why America may not be around at the end is war and terrorism. Matthew 24:6 states that a sign of the end is that there will be wars and rumors of war. Could that be what takes down the United States? As we look around our world, as we look at some of our relationships or lack thereof with certain countries, yes, that definitely is a possibility. The U.S. faces possible attacks from several enemies, Russia being one. They are increasingly hostile toward us. President Putin referred to us one time as a parasite. They are building alliances with countries such as Iran. And if you read in Ezekiel 38 and 39, where it talks about Magog and Gog, we'll talk about that as we go throughout our study here, that refers to Russia. The second country is China. China is developing stronger military forces along with growing nuclear arsenal. Because of their location and power, they can cut off trade routes around the Pacific Rim, and their leaders have been quoted as offering threats to nuclear attacks against the U.S. A third country is Iran. A revolution that began in 1979, deposing the Shah, taking many Americans hostage, is reaching a climax. Iran so wants the 12th Imam, their savior, to come, that it will do whatever is necessary to create the chaos around the world that they feel is necessary for that to happen, that they don't mind including attacks against the U.S. They encourage Muslims to attack us and to annihilate us and their neighbors. And they, too, are developing nuclear weapons and are getting buddy-buddy with Russia. Those three, plus terrorist groups in Afghanistan and Pakistan, are a tremendous threat to the U.S. And the threat is real and should cause us to remain focused on them as countries, lest they attack and take us down, as take down the only remaining superpower. The third reason why we may not be around at the end is natural disasters. Matthew 24 goes on, and Jesus teaches that at that time there will be famines and there will be earthquakes. It is possible that America is not around at the end because a natural disaster has devastated us. Think of this. 8 of the 10 most expensive hurricanes in American history have happened since 9/11. The worst being Katrina, which caused $100 billion in damages. Hurricane Katrina came in 2011, making 2011 the worst year for natural disasters in our country's history. In 2011, we also experienced the worst outbreak of tornadoes in 50 years, and Texas suffered the worst fire in its history. Earthquakes have become more rampant and abundant as well. It used to be that we didn't have to worry about earthquakes, right? We were just waiting for half of California to fall off into the Pacific, because that's the only place earthquakes were. Well, not anymore. In 2011, Virginia and much of the East Coast experienced the biggest earthquake since 1875. And when one of these events happened, it was characterized as historic or unprecedented. Even just a few weeks ago, if you watched the news, when they talked about the flooding in Colorado, they said it was flooding of biblical proportions. Clearly, we can see how the U.S. might experience a natural disaster so grand that it would cease to be a factor in the end time. And the final reason the U.S. may not be around is because of the rapture. Maybe that's why we're not mentioned. Maybe because when the church leaves, America just kind of ceases to exist, or fades off, or implodes in some way. As we saw last week when we talked about the rapture, we see that when the church is gone, chaos and confusion and devastation is left. Can you imagine what will happen with planes going down all over the place, with multi-car pileups wreaking havoc on all of our interstates and highways, when the stock market plunges, when insurance claims go through the roof? Economically, that would devastate this country. Not to mention, think about the condition of our country with the church here. Now think of the condition of our country without the church. Is it going to get better? No. Morally and spiritually, it will get much worse. Is that what devastates America? So, why do we care about this? Why have I spent this time scaring you to death about the country that you live in and love? Because I think that there are many lessons, but there is one major one that I want to share with you as we close. And it is this. Our salvation is not found in a restored America, but in a renewed relationship with Jesus Christ. We love this country, and we have loved ones who fight for it now or who fought for it in the past. And we don't want to see it destroyed. We don't want to see it come to ruin. We don't want to see it blown away into oblivion. We want it to succeed. But even if it does succeed, even if God in His grace and in His blessing pours out something upon our country and turns everything around, that won't redeem us. That won't get us right with God. That won't enable us to have an eternity with Him in heaven. God is sovereign, and He is in control of all things. Psalm 33:9, we read, says, "For He spoke and it came to be, He commanded and it stood firm." Genesis 1, we know that God created all things, including mankind, simply by speaking them into being. That is being in control. It's not as if God woke up one morning and He looked at America and He said, "Oh my goodness, what happened to this country? I go to sleep for one night and they go to ruin." No, it didn't take Him by surprise. It was all part of His plan. He is sovereign, and His will come to pass. So no matter which way America goes, our hope does not rest in America. Our hope does not rest in our congressional leaders. Our hope does not rest in a constitution. Our hope does not rest in whoever lives in the White House. Our hope is in the Lord. Psalm 33. "But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear Him, on those whose hope is in His unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. We wait and hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In Him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in His holy name. May Your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in You." Let's pray. Father God, as we look at the situation that we live in, as we look at our country, Lord, we understand that it is in need. But Lord, it's not in need of more laws. It's not in need of different leaders. It's in need of You. And so, Lord, as we look at all the stuff going on around us, as we look at a bleak future with uncertain end, might we, as Your church, as Your people, live, Lord, putting our hope and trust in You, the Sovereign One, the One who has all things in control, trusting that in the end, You win. You know the end game. Lord, thank You. Might we live each day with our hope placed squarely upon You, the hope that comes through Jesus.